Thank you very much. Sharadji, Srivats, members of the faculty, invited guests, student friends. Well, I stand at a very, I must say, at an advantageous position for multiple reasons. Number one, first and the foremost, is that just before me, we had a wonderful and a very exhaustive kind of understanding of what are the kind of challenges that face each one of us from none other than Dr. Rajiv Kumar, whom I had known for a fairly long time period, right from the time that he had been in the FICCI and some of the other organizations. I must say that it's been a wonderful kind of a treat listening to him. So therefore, my task, and that I was telling him, has become much simpler, because after listening to him, I could realize that possibly many of the things that I would like to possibly put down together over here have already been said, so I don't have to be spending too much of a time. And the second thing is that before him, a banker has spoken and dealt and gives us a very, very dismal kind of a scenario, you know, which is what a banker would possibly put it across to us to be more cautious. But I think as a management teacher and as a management professor myself for a long time period, I think we know we should be able to really see through some of the kind of things that are really happening around, and to be able to take as Rajiv said, to look at it more in a holistic manner, more in an integrative manner, than looking at it through one single frame itself. So it's that kind of a thought process that has really driven me in terms of putting some of my thoughts together this morning. I'd like to thank Dr. Rajiv Kumar for inviting me over, Rajiv Thakur to invite me over. As he said, almost about 2.5 months back, he called me up, and I said that we are still in 2016 trying to grapple with the things in 2016, but he was talking about 2017, February, and I said, at this point of time, things look to be perfectly fine, but as we said that, and therefore it was much easier for me to really confirm. And thank you for arranging the board meeting today, so that makes life still better. Well, it's a pleasure coming over to Jaipuria. I was telling Sharadji that my first visit to Jaipuria was in Lucknow, when I had given one of the keynote addresses there, when Professor Chakravarti was the director. And I'd known the institution for a fairly long time period, primarily because of my academic colleagues, my colleagues who have been a part of the system for a fairly long time period. And then, of course, professionally, we have known each other. Well, what I'm going to be talking about, and this is something which we would spend some little time in terms of looking at it a little bit more closely in terms of what are the kind of new things that we are confronted with. And if we take a look at it, many a time we keep talking about a whole lot of a world which is today threatened by protectionism, a world which is today threatened by terrorist violence, a world which is threatened by a whole lot of, let's say, civil unrest in different parts of the world. So we today find that, well, many a time when we are in various kinds of conversation, we say, well, increasingly this world has become a dangerous place to live in, and are we really at the right place to be in the very first place? But there's another view which says that, well, this is the best time to have. This is the best time to innovate. This is a time which is full of so much of an opportunity. America closes the door, but is it that the world has closed the door? Some of the countries, Britain moves out of your EU. Well, what happens to Britain? What happens to the entire economic union, the European Union? Does it mean that the opportunities are not going to be there? Start looking at it from an entirely different kind of a prism. And when we start looking at it from a different prism, we find there could be it's a time when we can possibly be have the best time to innovate. The fact is that we are living today in a world which is continuously getting disrupted, something that is today world become a cliche. The fact is also that disruption has also become a new normal today. If you don't get disrupted, then you need to ask yourself a question, why? Your own students today are disrupting the classroom, for example. And if they aren't, ask them why it is not happening. Your classrooms are getting disrupted. Our classrooms are getting disrupted. Our learning pedagogies are getting disrupted. And clearly, our own ways of doing the research are getting disrupted. So we'll talk about it as we really go forward. It's a world which is dominated by artificial intelligence. It's a world which is dominated by augmented reality today. Augmented reality is fast catching up. And it's a world where agile processes, big data, is the norm. Now, consequently, as a result of this, take a look at it, what is really happening. There's a new world which is now shaping up, a world which we had not known earlier. We've all lived, we've all educated, assuming that the kind of economic growth that we have seen in the past, the organizations, the vertical organizations that we have seen, the organization structures that we have seen will continue to exist. Today, the fact is that the jobs are not getting created in large companies. There are no jobs because automation is fast changing the entire scenario. Where are the jobs? The jobs are today, really speaking, in smaller companies. Because there's a whole lot of an outsourcing world which is there. Even in terms of the manufacturing, just take a look at it. An automobile plant today works with 1/4 of what a global major automobile plant would have worked a decade before. A global manufacturing plant or an automobile plant gets off to a start, like Mahindra, for example, puts up a plant to make Scorpio at almost 1/4 of what Toyota or Honda or General Motors would possibly do. And how did they do that? It is essentially the power of networking. It is essentially by looking at the suppliers, not just merely as your competitors, not just merely as the suppliers, but becoming a part of the entire design and manufacturing processes. So as a result of which, the jobs today no more exist in large companies. That has been the biggest kind of a contribution of this kind of a disruption that we are living in. Let us just take a close look at this kind of a world in which we are in. And clearly what we realize is, if the world and the volatility is something that has been talked about, we've all been talking about the words like VUCA and everything that we say. But the fact is that just take a look at the volatility. The societal changes. The societal changes are there for us to just take a look at it very closely. Just closely examine this. Demographic shifts in different geographies. America today, the Trump phenomena that you see is essentially the outcome of a demographic shift that has occurred in America. And it is the retaliation of a group which felt left out as a result of the demographic shifts that were occurring in America. The Hispanics, the migrants today constitute a very large proportion of that particular country. There's a very vast segment of Americans, the white American, who has been left out. It's that kind of a retaliation that is taking place. You look at Brexit. From whatever that one get to know about it, a Londoner never is in favor of Brexit. But you travel outside London and you realize that everybody wants Britain to move out of the European Union. So interestingly, these kinds of demographic shifts in different geographies is today creating a different kind of a social order. And this kind of a social order today is really creating another kind of a demographic or another kind of a political kind of a structures. This kind of a social change today also means that if we are not taking people together and if we don't really start looking at the organizations, not just merely from a cost perspective, but as Rajiv said, and today there's a big research which is going on in the area of conscious capitalism. And if we are not able to really spend some time on that, then I think we are going to be heading for a major problem. The political changes, increasingly we find that the world is moving towards more democratic structures, but at the same time we are also realizing that there is a growth of nepotism. There is a growth of dictatorial trends also in the in different parts of the world. We're also realizing that nationalism today is increasingly growing. Protectionism, closing of the markets, societies. This is something which is emerging out of those kinds of kind of a retaliation to those demographic shifts which have occurred. And clearly you find that there is a growth of the right-wing politics, which is laid towards the more of a dogmatic kind of a philosophy in policy framing. I am right and you are wrong. There is nothing in between. So this kind of a perspective which is today coming into policy making, it is a dangerous kind of a trend. It's a threat to any kind of a world that we talk about. And certainly we say the science and technology today is at the center of this change. However, having said this, the fact is that the century belongs to Asia, especially China and India, and certainly the Africa, which is today emerging as the next economic destination. We're all familiar with this kind of a person who comes to us, right? Who comes to study with us. Own understanding of the modern technology. He considers that, well, he's the next kind of a Bill Gates. He considers himself to be the next kind of a technocrat today. He has an unparalleled sense of hope. Unparalleled sense of hope. He believes, essentially, he's an eternal believer in the fact that things are going to be the same. The world is heading for something bright. And I have a future. That is, I think, is very important to us. Our generation, my generation, always thought, well, are we really going to be having another tomorrow? But this is a generation that says, no, I have a future. And I live in that hope of making my life better, which I think is distinctly different from the way we have looked at our world at the time when we were all growing up. Craving feedback. This is a generation that is continuously craving for the feedback and constant positive reinforcement. The whole Facebook today and the Twitter today is structured around that. Continuous feedback and positive reinforcement. So I put all kinds of my images. I go for a holiday, put my picture over there. I want a feedback. How am I looking? I saw over here when we were all assembling, some people were taking the selfies while we were all sitting down together. Right? These are the kind of a world, and we will put those selfies on the WhatsApp. Well, I was at the conference. Look at that. So, you know, this is something which is a very interesting kind of a world which we are in. This is a new generation, new set of values which are there. Strong set of social values, self-reliance, cooperation, collaboration, entrepreneurial mindset, risk-taking. I don't want to do what my father did. I don't want to do what my parents did. Shivas is an example, goes back, right? But there's another generation which will not. His son will not come back. His children will not come back into this business. You would have to look for somebody else to be doing this. So there's a very different kind of a mindset. The risk-taking is on a very different kind of a rise. This is a group which is comfortable with change. It's a group which is very comfortable with the opposite sex. We keep cribbing in our classroom, why are you sitting like that? We keep saying, why are you walking like that? Fact is that they are comfortable with that. You know, this is something with which we are all living in. And this is a world in which this kind of a differentiation thesis we have existed, and it's a rebel that we have in the classroom. It's a rebel in the market. Let me be candid. This is something that we see across the various markets that are there. This is also a rebel. The fact that they are the rebel makes them also the radical. Makes them radical. Makes them to take to violence when things don't fall the way that they have planned it out to be. They're willing to destroy. They're willing to take to the street to create a future for themselves. And this is the threat today, the world has today. This is a very serious threat. It's not just merely in our own country, but the world today has this kind of a threat. And therefore, we do realize that if the employment opportunities, if the opportunities to create, if the legal means of political expression, these conditions are not there, then in that case, it is bound to create this kind of a rebellion in the society. And this is where we've got to be looking at it. Globalization is something that we've all been talking about it. I don't have to be dwelling so much on it, but the fact is that the global brands, acquisition of global customer from a competitor, expanding markets, discovering new markets in countries like Africa or island countries in Indian Ocean, collaboration within the development and the global world is today the way to really be going forward. The global value chain today has become far more critical. So on the one hand, there is a protectionism. On the other hand, there is a globalization. The fact is that the forces of globalization will be far stronger than the forces of protectionism. The people who are going to be pulling out, people who are going to be closing the markets, are going to be left out. The rest of the world, which is 80%, is going to come together because of the economic reasons, because of the fact that the change is going to be occurring in these countries much more. So while these markets are going to get matured and will be with limited kind of an opportunities, we realize that the rest of the world is going to be the place where we are going to be having an opportunities. The disruptions that we see, therefore, is not just merely the political, the social that we are saying, and the globalization which is there, but it is also by the technology that I just referred to. And the most important thing is that the technologies that have the influence on the society are today termed as the disruptive technologies. Facebook, Twitter, all of them are considered as those that are having a major disruption, the effect of disruption in the society. Largely because of this reason that they significantly change the economic value and they have an economic impact on the industry itself. Now this is something which we do realize as happening across, whether this is Uber or it is any other kind of a world that we talk about. The whole world of design today is undergoing a change. Your and my telephones today, your and my phones are today designed not by the engineers sitting in the factories, but they are being designed by designers who understand not just merely the product, but more importantly, they understand how the human beings react to the technology. That is important. Understanding of the human being and the reaction has led towards the kind of a design. Some of these kinds of technologies which are majorly changing the world have been talked about by McKinsey. And one of the most important kind of the technology which is fast changing the world is certainly the mobile internet. The next is the next generation economics, the 3D printing. The 3D printing is really something which is right out over here. The products that are designed on the 3D printing may look ugly, but the fact is that they are designed in a shortest possible time period. And it is therefore for all of us to be using it. That it's going to change the healthcare. It is changing the civil engineering. It is changing the way the automobiles are going to be made. And clearly, it is the quantum physics which is making, and the material science which is making a world of a difference itself. All these changes today, and I will come back now into our education area. all this today means that the learning environment for all of us has fast changed. The world today is far more interconnected. It is technology driven. And therefore, the fact is that the learning is no more now restricted to the classroom. MOOCs today, they're one of those kind of a classical example, but more importantly, you take a look at it in terms of from where does this your student really learn today. Your student learns much more from the digital kind of tools that are available than from, let's say, just the classroom. So that means, in other words, technology today has become a critical resource in our learning environment. And the 21st century learning, therefore, will have to promote interaction. It will have to promote collaboration. No more now it is going to be teacher, student. It is going to be more and more collaborative learning. How do you learn with similar groups, maybe in the world itself? And if we are able to really put that together, I think that's going to be taking it forward. Collaborative problem solving and decision making. Somebody was just referring that, you know, the new jobs which are coming in will not just be the same. Take a look at it. From a very, very close quarter, if you start looking at a manufacturing firm, I just take a look at a manufacturing firm, the skill sets that they are requiring are no more just merely in terms of working on the shop floor or in terms of going out into the market and meeting the customer. It's the skills of problem solving. It's a skill of integration. It's a skill of analytics, the analytical skills. Now, these are the three big kind of a skill sets which have today emerged. Unfortunately, back in our own kind of a structures and back in our own systems, we really do not spend time in terms of looking at it. So one of the kind of a biggest kind of a challenge that we all have is to start looking at it in terms of what, how do we improve in terms of developing the high-end skills rather than the low-end skills. Selling is not going to be important because the internet is going to sell. The platforms are emerging, so aggregators will sell for you. So it's not going to be the salesperson who is going to be there. There's the death of a salesperson. There's the death of even the so-called the call center. Something that is going to be happening in the next couple of years, we are going to see the death of a call center. The back office, for example, which Abhik Barua talked about, increasingly the back office today, the roles are just diminishing. So where are those roles now? The roles are towards the higher end jobs, towards the higher end skills. And therefore, the collaborative problem solving and decision making have become critical. Even for the organization, even for our companies today, it is more in terms of the collaborative problem solving and decision making that is important. The 21st century, and this is something that Rajiv just talked about, synergy, the world of synergy is coming over here. Creating learning practices, human support environment that will support the teaching and learning of the 21st century. That means, in other words, you build a synergy between technology, your content, your learner, and the various kinds of pedagogy tools that you would like to put into place. How can you really bring about that kind of a synergy, the synergistic effect? Look at it in the organization. What happens in the context of an organization? In the organization today, the people who are working in various functions have to think in a synergistic manner. There's nothing called as a production problem. There's nothing called as an HR problem. There's nothing called as a problem of finance. When I look at my own university, I always say, we don't look at it as as just simply one functional problem. It may have a root some in a functional area, but the fact is, you start looking at all the functions together and see in a much and come out with a solution which is more synergistic in nature. And clearly, there's a whole lot of a world that we are referring to. So what is the new model of education? It's the new world that we are talking about in education and in management education particularly is going to be a borderless world. The flipped classrooms are going to be the next wave which are there. It's a world where learning can take place anywhere. The knowledge, Rajiv said, why do we have to recreate the wheel? We don't have to create the wheel once again. If somebody else is doing the work somewhere, how do you join that person through the social tools that you have available today? And it's a collaborative forms of learning. These are all technology enabled. This is an inclusive world that we are saying. The world in which employability will be the crucial term, word that is there. The student is coming to us not just merely for learning, not just merely for getting an MBA degree or let's say any kind of a graduate degree, but is also coming for the purposes of enhancing his or her employability. Innovation and entrepreneurship is the key word, and that's something that we need to be promoting. Organizations today are increasingly looking at individuals who can think in an innovative manner, who can work on their own and yet work in a collaborative manner. So what are the implications for management theory? And this is where I have something that I'd like to spend some little time, and these are going to be just that some of those last two bits that I want to leave behind, because I know that I'm addressing the management academics, and this is something that we need to be talking about it. It's very unfortunate that though there is a fourth industrial revolution that is taking place, fact is that the research in management theory today has ceased to exist. Take a look at it in terms of whatever the kind of projects that your students do, or your own PhD thesis, or the students who come out with the PhD thesis, etc. Much of the work is a very, very pedantic kind of thing. It's not looking at the future. It's not enabling you to understand the future. Fact is that the conventional management theory today is no more valid. We just heard about it, right? In terms of one example that Rajiv talked about was the theory of the comparative advantage, the Ricardo theory, ceased to have existed. How much time have we really spent in trying to understand what is the new basis for competitive advantage, where knowledge is the power, knowledge is the basis which is today fast emerging. So how do firms gain knowledge? How do societies become more knowledge-based societies? And what is happening to the organizations there? The division of labor that we talked about, the specialization that we talked about, the earlier conventional management theory, the span of control that we talked about, you know, all this today have ceased to exist. The new organizations are more technology enabled. These are all technology organizations. And if you view it from that kind of a perspective, then clearly we find that this is a very, very direct kind of an implication in terms of the research, and also in terms of looking at it, organizations from a different point of view. You just start looking at the organization, they're far more flatter today. They're not really vertical. Look at any kind of a manufacturing firm even. They're far more flatter today than what they were. A lot of levels have been removed. There's a direct connect, which is there, of the top man with the man on the shop floor. There is a collaboration and networking. More and more, there is a collaboration that is taking place on the workplace. More and more networking is taking place, not just merely with the people within the organization, but also with people outside the organization. The supply chain, there's more of a networking, more of collaborations which are taking place. Mahindra, I gave an example, where Tata Nano, and there is another example. You find that, well, they essentially work through a network of suppliers to design a product. These are hard, tangible products. Scorpio was designed not by engineers sitting in Mahindra only, but these were the whole lot of people sitting outside. The design firm sitting in Bangalore today work on terms of designing a whole lot of a product which is going to be used by you and me, but it is going to be made by another company. So this kind of a collaboration, the networking is there. The communications, look at the communications. The organization is today a web of communications. No more now it is a boss to subordinate, no more now subordinate to subordinate. You find that everything is really happening around. And the speed at which it flows by the time the boss gets to know about it, the damage has already been done. If there is a miss kind of a communication, or there is a rumor which has spread, or if there is something positive which is happening before the boss gets to know, there is already a positive result out over there. So the whole web of communication which is there in the marketplace and back in the organization. The organizations have become far more diverse in terms of the workplace. Customer integration today and customer engagement today has a very different meaning. The big data today is playing a very major role. While I was coming over from the hotel to your institute, I had one of the students who was escorting me, and he was talking about the digital marketing. And I was telling him that, look, how much of the time would you be spending on, let's say, the Amazon.com? And he was saying that Amazon is their dream company over here. Look at it in terms of the kind of big data that they work on. A whole lot of our customer data. Before you and I, you know, when you go onto the Amazon and you just tick on towards picking up one particular product, before you close, you have so much of recommendations that come to you, that so many people have liked other products, the same kind of a product. They tell you how many people have liked. They also tell you how many people have not liked. They also tell you what are the allied kind of products, so complementary products. And this whole data gets stored somewhere. When you revisit, they not only tell you what was your last purchase, but they also tell you what are the other products that they have acquired in the same kind of product category. This is something which is an output, but look at it at the back end. The whole algorithms that work essentially on the strength of the big data, the data that you and I leave. In fact, it's today a threat. Google today has a huge data on all of us in the world, and America today has an access to that kind of a database. There are no protection of them. There's no protection available to anybody. Right? So the fact is that the big data today is playing a very major role. Time and geography have also ceased to become redundant today. It's not. Time has ceased to be a reason for saying, well, I cannot respond now. It's a 24/7 world that we are living in, and agile processes and flexible technologies is the norm. Flexibility is the way that we are really looking at when we start looking at the organizations. And that's where I said that, you know, from a tall structure that you see in the picture, which is a very well-structured kind of a thing, right? That was yesterday. But you look at today, you know, the organizations are something like this. The structures are like this today. All mingled up. They're all collapsing. The structures are collapsing. And when the structures are collapsing, there's a kind of a very different kind of a teams that we are now seeing. Leadership, therefore, is about talent management today. It is about managing conflicting expectations. And a very important part, it is to be able to manage your personal lows. Today, the fact is that stakeholders don't mind, you know, shaming you, even if you're doing well. So you have to be prepared to face those kinds of lows. What is important is to be, and the customer can be very aggressive. You may want to hit the customer back, but the fact is that the customer holds the final purse for a final kind of a say in regard to your product acceptance. So managing your personal lows without it having an impact on organization performance is important. Managing contradictions in the systems is important. And gaining acceptance rather than demanding acceptance is the way that the new organization and the new talent is really saying. So the team that we are talking about, the teams have to work in an autonomous manner, and yet they have got to be interdependent. I often take a reference to the kind of terror groups. You know, it is wrong to talk about it, but I think it is great to learn from that. You take a look at, let's say, the Afghanistan war. You look at, let's say, how the guerrilla warfare works. You look at how any of the terrorist movement works. There's a team that comes, finding an obstacle in between. And this is a team of how many people? No more than one person, two people, three people. They would come. There's an obstacle in between. Turn around. Reach the same object through another kind of a route. They'll continue to pursue till the time the object has been achieved. And having achieved the object, they quickly disband and get lost somewhere in the jungles. It is that kind of a teams that you find organizations are all about. The new organizations are about such kind of teams who are talking about collaboration, cooperation, and competitiveness. And finally, we are saying we are heading towards entrepreneurial organization. So ladies and gentlemen, what I would like to put it across, therefore, is before we, just to conclude, that the world is a very different world in which we are all living in. It's a fact. It is requiring a new research. It is requiring us to closely examine the organizations. It is requiring us to closely examine the markets. It is requiring us to look at the technology as to how it is shaping up our world and what it is going to be having, what impact it is going to be having in the times to come. If we are able to put that together, I'm pretty sure that the quality of education, the quality of management education that we put together is going to be far, far superior. And let me mention that today we have the biggest opportunity. India today can really become, with America closing its doors, with all the kinds of visa restrictions coming into place, with Britain closing its doors with the visa rules, we have a great opportunity to do something over here. Let's see if we are able to make this really happen. Thank you very much.